from here. So, thank you very much, Professor Komaranth Narayan. Actually, I was editing, reviewing all my paper, I think, and I was very much benefited by his. And Sri Kavindra Ji on the chair.
Mic horizontal like Shah Rukh Khan.
Okay. So we are, I'm very happy to be among all of you so that we can share some of our efforts that we have been doing for past several years for the noble cause that was begun by our spiritual masters. So you can see this is Sripad Bhakti Swarup Damodar Maharaj, and he has a great contribution. Since more than 40 years, he was Nobel laureate, scientist from all over the world, and he left precious instructions. And then his godbrother, Sripad Bhakti Madhav Puri Maharaj, he has been giving us nourishment for this kind of work. Now, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, he just gave the vision of our mission, that when advancement of knowledge is applied, Lord, the whole process becomes absolute. The personality of Godhead and His transcendental name, fame, glory, etc. are all non-different from Him. Therefore, all the sages and devotees of the Lord have recommended that the subject matter of art, science, philosophy, physics, chemistry, psychology and all other branches of knowledge should be wholly and solely applied in the service of the Lord. The central point is that absolute is sentient. Absolute is not something impersonal or non-conscious. Rather, he is sentient, and therefore love or bhakti becomes fundamental in the Vedic approach. And here, the problem is that in modern science, we are neglecting the concept, the idea and form. And therefore, a dualistic view has arisen, which is actually defective, incomplete and impersonal. And Mahaprabhu, Gauranga Mahaprabhu, he has given the harmonizing principle, and so therefore he is known as the great harmonizer. So the foundational questions for the Vedic traditions has always been centered around these as questions: what is life, what is matter and this universe, and what is our relationship with the reality. So the Indic traditions, we come from the Indic traditions. There are other like the Christian, Islamic, Buddhist, but our contribution, it comes from the great sage Vedabhyas and all his followers, and it presents the topmost harmonization of all kinds of contradictions by explaining the concept of the absolute truth, which is the original person or Adi Purusha. So Vedantic is a personal of absolute truth, personal conception. And Tagore, Einstein actually met Tagore once. There was some dialogue. Einstein was interested in, you know, the external reality, the naive realism, but Tagore would not agree with that, and so they had a dialogue. So Einstein agreed with Tagore on one point, that beauty could not be conceived apart from human consciousness, but he could not agree the same with regard to truth. And so Tagore on the other hand replied, truth is the perfect comprehension of the universal mind, and it is also realized by human mind. So truth must have some relation with the subjectivity, with the thinking, with the rational part of reality, and which is being neglected in the more scientific approach in terms of what they call as objective or materialistic conceptions. So therefore we have to find a perfect rational harmony between the subjective and objective aspects of reality with which we begin our study. And so the interest among the Vedic philosophies, the Vedantic philosophies, was quite significant always among the scientists. For example, Schrodinger also wrote one chapter from Upanishads in his book called What is Life. Oppenheimer also quoted Bhagavad Gita after the explosion of the atom bomb. Then there was a German scholar called Hermann Gunther Grassmann. He translated the whole of Rig Veda into German language, and Grassmann actually gave a lot of mathematical concepts like the outer products, and also he talked about the quaternion theories, which are now very fundamental in astrophysical studies and cosmology. An Indian mathematician, Srinivas Ramanujan, said, "Sir, an equation has no meaning for me unless it expresses a thought of God." and also Fritz of Capra, he talked about Heisenberg, that when Heisenberg came to India and he met Rabindranath Tagore and they had discussions, and he was having some problems, you know, because of the outcomes of the quantum theory. But when he discussed with Rabindranath Tagore, he said, now quantum theory made some sense to me after discussing with Tagore. So first we should see what are the contradictions in modern science. This is the first point we have to understand. So there is problem in biology. First of all, we have no mechanistic explanation of the biological phenomena. It was being attempted when Francis Crick got the Nobel Prize, and he just said in the name of central dogma, there is the information of life is in the DNA molecule. But later on it was proved that DNA is also just a participant in the life process. It does not represent the actual information of life, but when it is part of the cell, then DNA is being utilized by the whole cell for the purposes of the replication and other processes. And so, like, for example, a lot of books are coming up now. Shapiro, McClintock was a Nobel Prize winner. She got prize for these jumping genes, which proved that the information of cell is, as far as the DNA is concerned, is only partial. So there is also information in the transient states of the cell. There is information in the epigenesis. So other things become important gradually. So therefore, DNA is no longer the central concept of life, and we have to consider the information as holistic in the cell. So therefore, the other part is that they never considered consciousness, sentient part of the living, you know, reality. And now that is becoming important. And how can you understand that cells are conscious or cells are sentient? So the thing is, if we write down the algorithms, then we can see concepts like intelligence, concepts of intelligence in those algorithms. For example, there are checkpoints, there are recognition of errors, there is error corrections. Then only when it is perfect, it continues. In other words, the errors, possibility of errors in a cellular process like replication is less than 1 in 10 to the power of 9, at least in yeast, bacteria, etc. So therefore, they are quite precise, but not in a mechanical sense, but in the sense of checking after the act. Means when the cell does things, it checks and makes sure that things have been done correctly. So this kind of precision process indicates a human engineered like a planned process. But the thing is that where is that intelligence located inside the cell? Because it is not something external but intrinsic to the life principle, so it must be understood that nature has an intelligence, and we must investigate this intelligence in the nature. That's what the Vedic seers are, you know, asking, that we must investigate what is the source of this intelligence, and then we will get something grand. So therefore, analytical conceptions are not sufficient to explain life. Analytical means the complete is sum of parts. That's not what the life exhibits. Rather, in life, we have to deal with holistic systems, and the holistic systems originate from other holistic systems. Like the father and mother produce a baby, then the baby goes on to produce further children, the bacteria produces another bacteria, the chicken produces an egg. But you see, neither the egg is simple nor the chicken is simple. So both are complete. So this type of logic we are seeing in life, and this cannot be made any more simple. So therefore, it is very difficult to understand what life is in terms of only molecular components. And then Sherry, he wrote a PhD thesis, and in which he investigated the problems of physics and chemistry. And Heisenberg also expressed this difficulty in no uncertain terms when he said, there is no quantum world. An abstract quantum physical description. It is wrong to think that the task of physics is to find out how nature is. Physics concerns with what we can say about nature. So therefore, there is no consensus in physics, in modern science, about what constitutes an objective reality. So the other part is that scientists are very much obsessed with the observables. However, they have to accept the unobservables, especially in the quantum field theory, without actually observing them. For example, we have the unobservable color degrees of freedom. When you do quantum chromodynamics, you have to accept this color theory, and then, but these are not actually observed very well. And then we always talk about the overall phase factor of the state vector of the entire system, which is taken to be unobservable. Then the satisfying the spin statistics relation requires a proliferation of hypothesized unobservable particles. But the complete unobservability of free quark color actually brings a bountiful reward for physics. So even though we don't observe them, such concepts are helping us progress the idea of physics itself. And Penrose wrote a book called Road to Reality, in which he deals in details about these unobservable states. Even the question, we see two types of fundamental particles, fermions and the bosons, and they both represent two different kinds of symmetries. But if after Big Bang, they separated as fermions and boson, then how did they break apart like that? So that's why they are searching for questions like supersymmetry and other ideas. And it takes physics to completely, what to say, a very theoretical foundation, and it is quite difficult to, you know, understand how really it happened. So therefore, an important idea in QFT, the field theory, is that any measurement process, the quantum system under consideration, cannot be taken in isolation from its surroundings. Means we cannot think about something only as in itself. It has contribution from the total environment. So we cannot isolate anything. So again, this is a problem for the analytical conception. Even physics is going towards a more holistic understanding, and rather than a particular type of understanding. Of course, this was a debate between Bohr and the other people in the field theory, like Heisenberg, Dirac, and especially Julian Swinger. This question, that when Niels Bohr gave the idea of the atom, this was just a picture. It was just a particle picture to help understand what might be happening inside the atom. But really, it was not actually a picture. Rather, we had to introduce later on many, many concepts like quantized fields and like the local fields. And so therefore, how much are the particle concepts Okay, sorry, sir. So this is a book written by Julian Swinger, and it's a very nice quote. And he wrote in his book this question, that we send electrons, protons into the various kinds of nucleons where we perform experiments in which these particles enter a very small region, like in the collider. We make no attempt to describe what goes on there and simply try to finally characterize what emerges when the particles are separated again. Is this the purpose of theoretical physics, to be no more than cataloging of all things that can happen when particles interact with each other and separate? Or is it to be an understanding at a deeper level in which there are things that are not directly observable, as underlying quantized fields are, but in terms of which we shall have a more fundamental understanding? So this is a deep issue in physics. You know, Feynman got the Nobel Prize along with Swinger, and Feynman is very well known for the path integrals. But those path integrals sometimes assume that the particle was always there, and they don't really go, into the deeper interactions which happen when things are not observable. So this was the question raised, because it raises some questions about the fundamental assumptions that we take up in science, whether the space is infinitely divisible, whether the particles are fundamental. These questions we have to consider now. So now that's why we have to take some guidance from the Vedantic sources, because the Vedantic sources are not like the sources of physics or chemistry, which began with the analytical approach. Of course, it has its value, but the Vedantic conception has always been the logic of organic whole. Organic whole means Om Purnamadaha Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnam Eva Avasishyate. The reality is complete in itself, and from that complete, original complete, so many complete units are coming up. And so we have to study not only the result that we see around each other, around in the environment, but we have to see how it began and also what is the process by which it comes to fruition in the form of different results. Conclude. So we have two basic axioms: life comes from life and matter comes from life. So this is the basic, what to say, first understanding that we must have. We can never produce life from chemical combinations alone. So then the question is coming, how the life principle is working out. And so since we cannot find the result in physics and chemistry, but in nature we find life principle, then we have to say the logic of life is dependent on life's own inner conceptual necessity. It is not external, it is something intrinsic to the life principle itself. And this will have to deal with the concepts such as inner purpose and desire. And these are hardly understood in physics and chemistry. So unlike chemical substances, in life the different limbs are not actually parts. They are actually members of the living form. So this is a limb. This is much more, what to say, intimate to me than a particle inside a box. You can replace a particle in a box, but you cannot replace this limb. It's, in that sense, it is coming from the whole itself. It's not an external addition to this total system. So this is the thing. That's why Kant told this thing, there will never be a Newton for the blade of grass. So there are many categories here, but I just tell one or two things. That biological causality is circular logic. It cannot be reduced to a linear causation, which is the idea of physics and chemistry. In fact, in physics also things are changing actually. However, this is not a mechanistic conception, that means. And the cause of integration of the members is located in the unity of the common purpose. So Vedantic concept of reality, a student begins with Trikuti Vinyas, means the knower, the known, and the knowing process. And we are neglecting in modern science, we are concerned only with the known, and we do not think about the contribution of the knower in constituting the object of our study. So this is the problem. So modern science is basically partial, or rather it is incomplete in its outlook. So therefore, Vedantic system is a dialectical approach leading to the concept of absolute truth as Adi Purusha. So it is not merely, of course, experiential aspect people can bring in, but to logic also it is possible to bring out the concepts of Adi Purusha. And Gauranga Mahaprabhu is the great harmonizer, at least in our tradition, and that's why we are following his teachings, and we are also teaching others the same thing. Consciousness has become a big subject today, but it remains an enigma. No one knows how consciousness actually arises. Some people say the after death, consciousness exists in some quantum state in the universe. But our question is that, if that was the case, then you could somehow make a consciousness system through some quantum collapse, which is being approached by some scientists like Roger Penrose and others. They have a theory, but they have no actual explanation, demonstration, how it. So therefore, quantum mechanics is barely, scratching a surface from the outside, but we need a totally different approach to understand consciousness. So it is not produced from matter, and therefore quantum processes will not deduce consciousness. That's our Vedic understanding. Previously, in the Aristotle system of logic, there was no place for contradictions. But due to quantum mechanics, these contradictions have become an integral part of modern logic. And so in that sense, it is good for us, because in Vedic principle, the contradictions are not unacceptable to have the understanding of the reality. So, okay, let's forget this. So the most fundamental principle of Vedic process is the Guru-Sishya Parampara. The Guru must be authoritative, he must be authorized by the previous system of the Acharyas. And in Vedantic philosophy, Srila Vedabhyas is the author of all these books. But this knowledge is timeless. And four schools of Vaishnavism are prominent in Vedanta, and one school of Shankara system is also prominent in the Kevala Advaita system, and they propagate the teachings of Vedanta. And Mahaprabhu is the great harmonizer of all these different philosophies. And the Vedantic paradigm is this: the foundational service relation between a guru and ananya shrota and a disciple in ananya shrota dhara means amnaya, means unbroken chain of disciplic succession must be maintained to have the real knowledge, and then the great sages will be able to help such a disciple. So let's I wanted to tell many things, but not time is there, so I just wanted to tell something important. There are many things could be said. Anyhow, so we must have some practical proposal. So there is a proposal that we have for the harmony. Basically, we have two principles, axioms: life comes from life and matter comes from life, and how can we push it among the scientific community. So there are some experiments in the literature, American Journal of Clinical Nutrition, and actually this work has been done since last 100 and 200 years also. Athwater and Benedict did the first experiments on human energy and correlation with the food intake. And later on in 1980s, 70s, 80s and 90s, Webb and his team did a lot of significant experiments in which they placed a few human subjects in a confined situations, and they very accurately noted the amount of food intake, the work done, and also the energy losses. And interestingly, they found there is some amount of energy which could not be, it could not be accounted for. And so it remains a mystery what is the exact relation between food intake and the storage. That is, the how the mass, the biomass, the body mass, it relates with the food intake. And that's interesting for us. So let's see the next slide. I made a slide here. So there are one experiment, there are four men inside the room, and they took rest whole day, means not sleeping but just rest, and in night they slept. And they, when they measured this quantity, they found it is within plus or minus 3%. But when two of the men remained awake for 24 hours, this difference increased to 279 and 393. Two men means they're a little different. So, but when one they further eat very less and double their work, then this unaccounted energy further increased. And then some mild work, just these two, just some mild work, then it is the negative side. So, and these are the references. So they only said we missed something, but I think we did. They said we were very careful in our experiments, and they wrote that little heat storage was evident in these experiments, and hence therefore heat balance was present, but the energy balance was not present, which was not traceable to anything. The Webb et al. Noted in the group of 13 experiments, it appeared that the greater the food deficit, the larger was the unmeasured energy, means excess of metabolic expenditure over loss of energy. In the 52 sets of data from studies lasting 3 weeks or longer, where all the terms of the in the balance equation except Qx were either directly measured or could be readily estimated, the average value of Qx amounts to 705 kilocals per day, or 27% of QM, which is quite significant. He said further, it is not possible to predict with confidence what change in body weight will result from particular paradigms of food deficit or food surplus. If the theoretical basis of energy exchange and storage is incomplete, the prediction of weight change will be difficult to derive successfully. So this observation is very good for us, because according to our conception, the soul, which is the basis of life, is transcendental to matter. And this material energy, it comes out from the living energy, the soul. That means the life, matter comes from life. But modern science thinks the opposite, that life came from matter. But we have no proof of that in any of our experiments. There is not a single demonstration that they could make a bacteria or a blade of grass. By combining all their experiments in all their labs, in all the time that they have done the experiments. So therefore, on the other side, if you ask to talk about evidence, because science is based on evidence, we always see different life forms are giving birth to life forms. And when we are life, then hairs are growing, nails are growing, so matter can come from life. But we never see the opposite. But why they, bring up such logic? Like if someone says the sun you always rise from east, but the first sign has arisen from the west, then we have to ask what evidence you have to speak like this. So we have to ask scientists what evidence you have to say that life came from chemicals. Rather, the opposite is always evident. So this is a kind of, you know, what to say, dogmatic assertion of this materialistic propaganda, which we are challenging due to the instructions of our spiritual masters. Conclusion is this. Vedantic aphorisms completely reject the notions of scientific materialism, such as the from chemicals. Much support for Vedantic as well as Kantian and Hegelian concepts are being inferred from the frontiers of biology, physics and chemistry. Objects cannot be thought of as existing independently of the subject. This is also a beginning conclusion of Vedanta. The Vedantic understanding is that matter comes from life. This principle should be experimentally verified, and it will open new light on the question of origin of life and origin of matter, and will also demonstrate the inadequacy of physics and chemistry in explaining life. Life is a higher category and cannot be produced from matter, and rather opposite must be verifiable. Thank you.
Well, I have this growing sense of discomfort that we are trying to prove, we should prove something, a principle in its own terms, not in terms which are alien to that principle. Now, in terms of materialist philosophy, stars are transient coagulations of, you know, haphazard nebulae. Life is a colloidal accident. Man is a compound of chemicals destined to disintegrate. And all these creative ecstasies in our conference are but bright incidents in the protoplasmic pullulation of the earth. But in terms of Vedantic philosophy, what is pravritta or centrifugal initially is centripetal, finally. I mean, and so the initial contraction of consciousness is followed by an expansion of consciousness. It becomes inclusive. And man is an infinite circle whose circumference is everywhere, but center is in one place. God is an infinite circle whose circumference is nowhere, center is everywhere. So man becomes God if he multiplies infinitely, his center.
Excuse me, can we quickly, we have just 2 minutes.
So what I'm trying to say is that this is, I mean, one should not try to vindicate, you see, the philosophy of life in terms of science which has no understanding of the science of consciousness.
No, we are saying science of consciousness, but first question is how consciousness arises. So, most studies in modern science about consciousness studies is based upon just neural correlates of consciousness. So there is some frequency, creeping, somebody is angry. Okay, this is fine. We have no problem with that. But does it explain how the hard question of consciousness is to be solved? It's a, that's why Roger Penrose has proposed this orchestrated reduction. But they go into microtubules and other type of areas of brain. But the thing is that really, consciousness is not merely in the brain, it is in the plant also. And where is the, you know, what to say, brain in the plant or in the single cell amoeba? So this whole question that it originates only in particular locations is quite, what to say, no, it's just a kind of a supposition. And we can raise a question, what is so unique about those areas of brain that consciousness arises only there as far as life is concerned?
We have time for 2 quick questions. There's one here and then one in the back.
When we look at the creation, the one, the many came from one.
Yes.
And Maya came from the one. Mm. So when Tattvamasi, Aham Brahmosmi, prajnanam brahma, the end result is sarvam brahmam. There is nothing that is lifeless. Everything, the whole of cosmos is a living entity. Particularly when we look at our own cells in the body, that one cell manifested into the 200 trillion cells.
I understood your question. May I
answer? To make this body, mm-hmm. Similarly, when you take it to the microcosm, to the macrocosmic level, the whole of cosmos is a living entity. There is then the question of matter and life doesn't come, because everything is a living, functioning entity. There are electrons revolving, there is movement.
Let me answer.
Rhythm.
I understood your question.
Okay.
Let's not waste time. So, according to the Vedic principle, not everything is life. There is the super energy, which is living entities, and the inferior energy, the Bhagavad Gita, ab bhumi rapo anala vayu kham mano. So this are the inferior prakriti, and life principle is the which dharana, which holds the things together. So that is the first misunderstanding. And second thing is that you may say like that what you are saying, but the Brahma that is not being transformed. What is being transformed is a shakti. That's why the Gaudiya philosophy is not Brahma Parinamvad, rather it is Shakti Parinamvad. So you have to study these things in some detail.
Last question, short question, please.
Yeah, short question. You quoted research which was published in 1980 on energy deficit.
Yes, yes.
Are there any more recent papers? Because if you could indeed show it to the satisfaction of scientists, this would be revolutionary. People will win Nobel Prizes. Why haven't papers been published since 1980?
This American Journal of Clinical Nutrition, which published this paper, I tried to search this, whether it is being repeated in the, I just could not find. But if you try, you may find something. But the thing is, this is nothing new. This has been done in the 18th century by Atwater and Benedict, and they also found some deviations. But they just cover it up by saying average, statistical average. But here we have to think about the specific cases like obesity, like fasting, like overeating. So we cannot statistically make it like even. So that's what this was, a contribution of these authors, and I think it is an interesting work, even if nobody has repeated it.